All right, are we up? All right, this is going out. Checking the stream. Okay, got audio, should have audio. I've got a few computers running here. So now the frame rate, now that I've actually gone live, the frame rate has dropped to 6 frames, now up to 16, 7 frames a second. So yeah, and I'm looking at the feedback here from YouTube. It says video output low. So when I was doing the countdown, it was 25 frames at 720. And now it's, okay, the frame rate's coming up a little bit, but the stream health is very low. So as soon as I started running the video with the animation, it started buffering in the feedback. So, but we got 233 people watching right now. So you may have buffering. Well, you're probably, yeah, you're guaranteed to have buffering. but I'm seeing the live chat. I got the chat on a separate computer, trying to save the clock, but we're still dealing with bandwidth issues because it is Saturday in Philadelphia, and the people, they like their streaming stuff on the weekends, so we're getting the urban bottleneck of clock on them, their internets. All right. So, yeah, let's see here. Here we go. Yes, I'm looking. I see you on the chat. 7 frames should be enough for anyone. Yeah, well, I might be somewhat animated. And, it's going up and down, but we're going to have some buffering. Yeah, intermittent. Okay, well, it is sort of working, half. Is the, the frame rate is so low that the audio latency, you probably couldn't tell if it was latent or not, but it should be synchronized. I did a test this morning. The test, I was running in the green totally at 25 frames, but now that it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon, I don't know if it's the traffic of people logging on to the stream or what. I don't know why it bogs down as soon as I go live. I don't know. It shouldn't make a difference, but I guess it does. The buffering is bad. Yeah. See, there's nothing I can do here. This is YouTube cutting me out. I'm looking at my live feed, and I'm doing 720. And I'm looking at the feedback here on the other monitor, and it's just a wheel going around. So looks like we just don't have the bandwidth to do this. This is weird because I'm going to keep talking even though it's probably not going out. Bad buffering for a live stream. I agree. Like I said, I did a live test about an hour ago at 720, and I was getting 25 frames and no buffering. And everything was in the green. And then, so I did the test, ran the pre-roll with the animation and the clock, and it started out in the green, and then it went to the yellow. And then as soon as I went live, it's going in the red, and it's been red ever since. So, I don't know. I'm gonna shut down a computer. Get one computer offline, see if it helps with the bandwidth at all. Works at 240. Yeah, buffering, yeah. Tell them to stop watching baseball. That's the problem. The reason I'm doing this live, I had stopped doing the live broadcasts, because in the old location, I just couldn't get it to work. There was just, the bandwidth was just too limited. When I moved here, I got an upgrade to the cable, and I had the guy came out, did a test, and it was like 4 times the upload speed that I had in the old place. And so I was encouraged to try and do a live stream, and so I did that test about an hour ago this morning before breakfast, and it was really good. It was all green. But after I went live, YouTube, it's been red ever since I went to the live cam. The stream health has been red. And on my side, it's sending. I have the encoder synchronized with YouTube. So as the bandwidth goes up and down, it's buffering. It's sort of changing the frame rate to synchronize with the bandwidth that's available. So I'm looking at my send, and it's currently at 17 frames at 720. So that's synchronizing on my encoder end. But on the YouTube end, it still says the video output's low. I wish they would give more information on the YouTube side as to like the frame rate and stuff that it's getting, but maybe that functionality is in there, but I just can't find it. But it's just giving me red, and it's buffering. So I took into consideration there might be a buffering problem, so I had it set up to allow for latency so that if you don't want to watch absolutely positively live, you could, I guess, technically pause it, let it catch up, and then you should be able to watch it without the buffering. That's kind of the idea that I had. Maybe it works that way, maybe it doesn't. You can maybe let me know in the comments. Yeah, so it's saying here, people are saying it's really bad. Yeah, I suggest trying to drop the resolution a bit on your playback end and see if that helps because of the buffering. But or you might try pausing. Just pause it for a minute and then watch it kind of not 100% live, like 60 seconds from live, and it might cure out the buffering issue if you want to try that. Yeah, I know. I'm saying that people are saying drop the broadcast. Yeah, well, I'd have to stop the broadcast too. I can't do that on the fly. But if you on the receiving end drop it from HD down to 360 or 480, try that. Or like I said, try hitting the pause and wait. But yeah, this I guess this is kind of ridiculous. But I'm, you know, nothing I can do. Okay, so we're still trying to get a new stream key from YouTube. Restart the transmission. Well, so yeah. So are we going to bail on this and start at a lower resolution? Okay. How many people are watching here? We got 237 people watching, so I'm going to change my 360, yeah. I'm decreasing my my monitor rate, so I might be able to increase my output bandwidth. I don't know. I'm still reading the feedback here. What you're saying about the resolution. 480 is jumping a bit. Okay. Buffering at 144. So well, that doesn't make any sense because I'm, you know, so this is a YouTube side issue. I don't understand why that would be. Why are they? Why isn't YouTube transmitting me at 720? If I'm right here, I'm transmitting to YouTube 20 frames at 720 currently, and that the encoder is synchronizing. But YouTube is not delivering that. People aren't getting that. Okay, 480 is fine for me. Okay, so what's the stream bit rate? What's the stream bit rate? It is variable depending on the bandwidth. So I've got them synchronized. Google speed test. Yeah, we did that. We did that in the off time. But that's what happens is you do the speed test when you're not really taking up any bandwidth, and it's spectacular. And then you make a demand, especially on upload, and the cable, the Comcast, they see that you're trying to upload, and then all of a sudden, they just squeeze your bandwidth down. You know, that's what happens every time. It's green before I go totally live. When I go live and synchronize with YouTube, the bandwidth just, it just disappears. So who's doing the throttling? I don't know. I've got no stuttering now. Okay. It's still the video output is still low. All right, I'm going to just keep on with this, and you know, you can always, if it ends up being on those YouTubes, if it's not, the buffering's not too bad, you might want to watch the higher resolution version in the replay. But it's kind of weird that YouTube is not delivering the 720 live. Why is that? Why is it that you can view it in 480 live on the other end and not 720? I don't know. Answer that, YouTubes. Okay. So what's going on in Franland? Well, this is the new office. There's the lab back there. This is the lab, and this is the new office, sunlit, as it were. And I had a lot of little things. The reason I kind of wanted to do this live broadcast is I ended up accumulating all these little bits, and I thought, well, the general YouTube audience is not really tolerant of these kind of weird off-topic little videos being popped up. People are like, what's this got to do anything? So I thought I'd just put everything in one big live broadcast. I was just hoping it would be better resolution. But anyway, I digress. So what's going on in the background? Well, I'm still unpacking. Back there, if you remember when I did the plate echo video, those of you who are really keen might have seen in the far corner of the frame, there was all these crates stacked up. Well, that's because to clear out the lab to do that video, I had to, all the crates that still weren't unpacked, I stacked them all up, and there was a whole wall of crates going down the side, at least like 16 of those big crates. And so I'd spent the week going through most of those, although there's still a lot. I don't have like the test equipment set up. I'm still trying to arrange like storage in the corners and stuff. I'm trying to get every nook and cranny to get everything out again. The projects that I had packed up from the old lab, because there were about a dozen long arc projects that I had in various stages of completion, those were all in my wire rack, and I had to box and pack them up individually. And they're sort of in the crate storage, but I have to go through and reorganize them and recondense them into their various project shelves to get so that I can get my mind back into doing them again. That has to be done yet. I'm doing work over at the factory too, because I've been having to do things over there that I don't have the room to do here for various reasons, and so I've been trying to start up some older projects over there, and on the sideline too, I've been sort of obsessed with woodblock printing, so I've been spending some time on the off hours, if there are such thing as off hours, for me to begin to learn the process of doing multicolor block printing. What I will show you this. I'll show you this. Where is it? Come on. I'm trying to get the hang of this. Okay. I have this book, A Treasury of Japanese Woodblock Prints, and this is from my own library. And if you know nothing about Japanese woodblock printing, it's this fascinating art form, centuries old, goes back to the 1600s. I don't want to break my book. Yeah, that's a very famous one there, the Red Fuji. This book's too heavy to. This book's too heavy. I don't want to break the spine. It's an old book, but Philadelphia Museum of Art, they have a current exhibition about woodblock printing. Sorry. And this is what, let me show you this here. Oh, come on. Okay. I'm trying to, hang on here. Okay. So this is video. Okay. Zoom. Okay. So this is a triptych from, I think, 1883, I think it says on there. But this is an example of the full color woodblock printing. Yeah. Ooh, all right, that's working. So this is this is all done with, this is three different prints bound together in a triptych. And I'll get a close up here. Oh yeah, okay, this is working. All right, so this is another close-up here, and this is the detail, and this is a wood block. So all of the lines you see here, that's actually where the wood is contacting the paper, and all of the places where there isn't ink is where it's cleared away. So these pieces of wood are extremely fine. And to give you an idea, this is a close-up photo they had of an actual wood block that had been used for a print, and you can sort of see the detail. This is a very, very, very close-up shot. So it's a very marvelous, disciplined art form, and they do the separations with this sort of, let me see here. No, I guess it doesn't allow me to do that. Oh, here we go. Okay. So here's an example. I'm going to zoom out a little bit here. Here's a woodblock, a multicolor wood print. And they had above here, this is just the one color. And you see, and they do that, and so they make a block just for this one color, and then there might be six or eight different blocks to make a completed print, all done by hand. So this is what I've been trying to experiment with, this process using linoleum blocks, and in my off hours, it's a very tedious and frustrating process, and I'm hoping that if I can get like one block to print, that I'll do a multicolor, and maybe I'll do a series and offer them for, on the, that's something to help the channel, you know, if I do a series of woodblock prints, maybe make them available or something, but I'm doing that in the off hours. But I'm fascinated with Japanese art. In fact, I'll show you something. I don't know if this is going to come up in the, there's a really huge lag. I'm looking over here at the lag over there. That's, oof. Okay, so. This is mine. I own this. This is a Kano. Oh, come on. It's a lot of reflection off the glass. I'm trying to get a. Okay. Yeah, it's very reflective. I have to get museum glass for this with the non-reflective. Let's see, it's just showing the monitor. okay. Let's see if it shows. Well, anyway. This is a Kano. It's a Japanese scroll. Oh yeah. Okay. There we go. Yeah. This was painted by Kano Nakanobu. It dates from 1790-ish, 1790s, and Kano Nakanobu's real name. In the Kano art school, they would adopt a name, sort of like if you were in the Ramones, you become a Ramon, you know, Marky, Johnny, Ramon, whatever, but the real name is something else. And so the artists that worked in the Kano school in the Edo period, they adopted names. So Kano Nakanobu, his real name was Akawa Hogan, painted this in the 1790s. So it's a, yeah, silk scroll, and it's in my personal art collection. One of my more cherished pieces. I'm looking at the feedback here, and there's an amazing delay. I'm looking at stuff that I broadcast like 5 minutes ago. It's actually broadcasting live now, so it looks like the buffering seems to have been seems to be over with a little bit. I don't know. Anyway, is the buffering doing okay? Well, yeah. The problem is this: there's such a big lag that anything I say now is gonna be you're gonna see it like 5 minutes from now. It looks like, it looks like the feedback's looking good. Okay, so, I've been trying to do the wood block prints with linoleum blocks. I figure if I can do it with the linoleum blocks, I can work my way up to hardwood. But I'm fascinated by it. It's a technology and an art in one. It's really. So I guess that's why it's synchronized with my fancy so much, the woodblock prints. Anyway, I digress. All right.
Don't make me mad. Don't make me mad. First name, mister. Quit your chibber jab. I pity the fool. Don't give me no back talk. Quit your chibber. Don't give me no back talk, sucker. I pity the. Don't give me no back talk. Don't give me no back. Don't give me no. Quit your chump. Give me no. Don't give me no. Quit your chump. Give me no back talk, sucker. I pity the fool. Don't give me no back talk, sucker. I pity. Don't give me no. I pity. Don't give me no. I pity. Don't give me no. I pity. Don't give me. Don't give me no. Don't give me no. Don't give me no. Don't give me no back talk, sucker. Shut up, fool. Shut up, fool. First name, mister. Middle name, period. Last name.
Tea. Never gets old. I love Mr. T in your pocket. Love him. Yeah. So, yeah. I'm sorry. I'm goofing off a little bit. Fran has a Rubik's Cube. You can see the Rubik's Cube? Oh, it was in the reflection. Yeah, okay. Yeah. I thought about doing a video about the Rubik's Cube, about, you know, because a lot of people think that you can't solve the Rubik's Cube, but anyone can solve the Rubik's Cube. It's easy, and I even thought about like solving the cube. Although that would probably be like watching paint dry. I'm not a speed cuber. I mean, I can solve the cube in like under 10 minutes, but I don't have like all the all the algorithms is like quite memorized, so I'm slow on it. But you know, I thought about, you know, solving the cube, but then I thought, no, that's I'll put that on the back burner, solving the cube. But yes. All right. It looks like someone says they got 720 with no buffering, so it looks like YouTube is giving me some bandwidth. It says you lost sync. Is that audio sync? Is the audio sync off? I lost sync. Is it there? Mm-hmm. All right. Anyway. Okay. So yeah, basic some stuff going around Philly town. I thought maybe. Put this over. I thought maybe you'd appreciate this. This is very Philly. yeah. Fire hydrant repurposed. Philly style, was fire hydrant, now trash can. But at least we're throwing out our trash, right? Anyway, I thought you'd appreciate that. another thing, when I was out walking around, I came upon a very interesting sight. I'm gonna show you this. You might find this interesting. There was all these flashing lights, and it was this. A truck had wasn't following the signs, and ran their trailer under a bridge and got pinned. They were not reading signs. Let's see here. I'll show you this here. This is see if this works. Come on. Oh, here you go. Okay. Look at that. Ouch. Yeah, the it was like up in the rafters. The roof was torn off like the top of a tuna can, and it was up into the rafters, so they couldn't actually drive the thing out. They had to drop the trailer down with a hydraulic lift. I watched them do it. So let me show you here. It was pretty fascinating, just the mechanics of this disaster. Yeah, okay, so. So yeah, this is it here. But seriously, folks, as far as like the city of Philadelphia goes, when we say 12 feet, we mean 12 feet. So it's in here. My system's getting slow. I'm waiting for these. Come on. Here you go. There you go. Yeah, 12 feet 11 inches. That's what we mean. 12 feet 11 inches. It doesn't mean like 12-ish feet. Yeah, you gotta know the height of your rig. Well, now someone out of town not paying attention. That's what happens. Yeah. Oh, anyway, I'm gonna clear that layer. I got a view of the IMAX projectors running, and I want to show you that. This is at the Franklin, at the Franklin Institute. They have a IMAX theater, it's a frame rate thing. So let me show you this. Yeah, this is the IMAX running. You probably able to see this on the version. This is unedited footage. This is just from a camera, but got these two big platters. Got the 70 mm film, or 65 mm. I'm not sure. I think it's 65. But you've got one feed platter, one take-up platter, and the film. It goes all the way up on these just the projectors up on the trees. So I was watching the platters feed the film like up into the air, and it's going up like two stories up to a hole in the roof, up to where the projectors are. It's pretty amazing. I'm going to show you here. See if this works. See if this does this. All right, let's see here. Oh, no. Okay. Yes, no. Okay. I'm just going to clear that out. All right. No, for that. Also, I got space food. I wanted to try these out. These are freeze-dried peaches. Astronaut food. I've never had astronaut food ever, but I was gonna do a video on astronaut food and was doing some initial research on these because whenever you go to like a science museum, they'll have astronaut ice cream, astronaut fruit, astronaut food, and everything, and a bio on the back about how since the early '60s astronauts have been eating this. I don't know. But, I went on the NASA website finding out if they actually eat astronaut food on the ISS, and they're actually strangely vague about it. The only thing they say is that they eat the same foods up there that they eat on Earth. The only thing that they mention is that there's no refrigeration on the ISS, which I thought was really strange because you're in space. It's like you got the most efficient refrigerator and freezer that you could ever want. All you have to do is like put something in a vessel where it's not insulated on the other side, and it's just a space, and it's like minus 200 degrees. It's like you could, you'd think that it'd be very easy to refrigerate something on the ISS, but apparently it says they don't have refrigeration for foods. But I wouldn't think that they are eating dehydrated foods because you got to take the water up. Anyway, because if you hydrate the food, you gotta add water to it. And I know they recycle their urine and stuff, but they do like have fresh. They do recycle like water and stuff. They do have to eventually abort it. So I don't know. I don't know if they actually are still eating. And you couldn't really subsist on just dehydrated food. I think that if you ate just dehydrated food and water, that by the time it gets to your colon, you'd just be poo and cement, I would think. I don't know. Anyway, I want to try this this out. So, I'm gonna break the seal. All right.
All right. Here we go.
Oh, it's a burst of powder. I'm gonna get peach lung. Look like corn chips. Smells like a peach book. It's weird. It smells like peach paper is what it smells like. Yeah. All right. Get into the Asmir thing here. First impressions. A little disappointing. It doesn't have a lot of flavor in it. It's not as much flavor as like a dehydrated fruit. Like a dehydrated apricot or a dehydrated peach. Like if you were to just have a regular dehydrated peach, it would probably have a lot more flavor in it. And I think that's explained by the process of freeze drying, because part of the research I was doing, because I wanted to do a video about this, I was going to try to rehydrate some of this food, because apparently if you add warm water, freeze-dried food should return to like its state. So like these mummy crisps, technically I guess if I put them in hot water, they would rehydrate into like peach slices. I don't know, but apparently the freeze-drying process, the way they do it is, first you take the food, whatever it is, and you flash freeze it, just like you would frozen peas or anything that you get like in the frozen food section is flash frozen, meaning it's frozen very quickly by immersing it in a very, very, very cold like liquid, you know, super, super cold. You get it frozen really fast, and that prevents the formation of the larger ice crystals that sort of cause food to go goopy. Birdseye, I guess, was the guy who discovered that, because he was on some Arctic expedition and got some fish that had been like thrown out like in the Arctic where it's very, very cold, and this fish had been flash frozen, and when he got it home, he kept it frozen when he got it home and thawed it, it didn't turn to jelly. It was like just, it tasted like fresh fish. And so he was keen to figure out how this process worked and eventually come up with the idea of flash freezing, which is what we use for everything. All frozen food is flash frozen, but the freeze dried method is the food is flash frozen in a pressure vessel, and once it's actually frozen, then all of the atmosphere is evacuated out, and the ice in the food turns to water vapor, steam, So it's like flash frozen, and then it's like flash dehydrated. And the very rapid dehydration apparently preserves the structure of the food while completely dehydrating it. All the water leaves. It's like 100% dry. So, but I guess that's the way they do all freeze-dried foods. But, yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't want to live on this. If I made it all the way to space and I had to eat that food like that, I don't know, I'd probably be wondering if I could come home, have a fresh peach instead of this dehydrated stuff. But hey, you know, it's space food. Okay. Did the space food. All right. Yeah, I've been sorting out the drafting room, which is back there. I guess you can see, yeah, that's the drafting room. Drafting room of the last weeks after as I've been clearing out the lab, the drafting room has basically been the land of crates. So I've been shoving everything in there, and it was just, you know, above eye level storage, just packed. But I needed to set up my drafting table and my other drawing table and everything. And there's also like some storage shelves in there I'm trying to set up and populate. So I've been going in and out of there, taking the crates out and unpacking and then putting them back. I've been doing that in the off hours too. So that's taken up some of my time. So this month, I sort of had a burst of videos there, but the content is going to slow down a little bit because the next couple weeks, I'm trying to sort things, trying to get things ready so I can actually get back to work. But I don't have, I have to get an exhaust thing set up to go from my bench to the window. That's going to take me a while to build because I got to build a converter for the window box and, you know, the flue system so I can evacuate fumes and stuff. And I don't have that built yet, so I can't really like solder because I don't have like ventilation yet. I'm still moving things around and unpacking. I haven't even hung my artwork or anything. That's why I kind of got the art sitting around, stuff like that. So yeah, still trying to get together. But so the next couple of weeks, content is going to be a little on the light side as I try to get all these fine details so I can actually get back to doing the lab work. Because there are a few principal long arc projects that I had to shelf last fall that I want to get finished, and trying to get them all together. Like I said, they're in pieces. I got pieces over in the factory, pieces here, and I'm trying to reaccumulate and get everything together, and also getting the workstation set up again so that I can actually do the work that I was doing before in the old factory, being able to do it here. So the fine details of that are going to take up, you know, a good portion of the next couple of weeks. So I might not have a really exciting video in the near future, but I'm going to try. Also, I appreciate the patrons hanging in. There was a bit of a purge in the, as I expected, you know, it's springtime. So in the United States, people get their taxes and, you know, you gotta make hard choices and stuff. So, I'm hoping to make it up later in the year, you know, bring my patronage back up. It's sort of it's funny because when I talked about the financing thing with the GoFundMe thing, I had a good surge in people like upping their pledges and new people coming in. But then curiously, this is the interesting psychological thing. Most content creators who work on Patreon, they don't ever talk about what they do with the money. They just take the money in, they just spend it, they make videos, whatever. They don't talk about it. But I think it's interesting and important. You know, I want to be transparent, and I pay a bit of a price for that transparency, because for every person who's apt to like increase their patronage because of my transparency, there's another person who's going to have the opposite feelings. So it's this weird teeter-totter of people who are like, I don't want you spending money on glow pencils, you know, and take, you know, because it's almost even Steven. So like the people who have been pitching in a little bit more are just about nosing for the people who've been bailing. So it's been like this. The Patreon's pretty flat, but like I said in that video, I'm planning on rectifying the financial issues by the end of the year. I gotta get the channel running again. I gotta make regular content. We're just not there yet. I mean. And I did come to realize a couple weeks ago where I was really hit the wall, and I was really just exhausted, because after the move I just kept going and wasn't taking any days off or anything, and I sort of started getting sick, and I took a couple days off, and in that time I realized that it had been weeks since the move. But I was still under extreme stress, not because there was anything to worry about, but because I was just psychologically still in the wartime footing of battling the move. And I had to take a little time off to really sort of get my mind, and I've been trying every day to remind myself that it's behind me. But I'm because of the way that I am, it's very hard for me to sort of separate the emotional part of things and get the emotional part of my brain to communicate with the rational part of my brain. That's one of the weird disconnects that I have in my between my upper and lower brains. So the underlying stress of the whole move thing, because it was like 6 months, it was like a 6 month ordeal. I wasn't over it yet, and I'm still unwinding from that. Every day I get the panic and the fear, and it's like I have to wind it back. It's like, no, it's over. You know, we did it. It's over. But there is that need too, for the next couple of weeks, especially for me to take the foot off the gas pedal a little bit, and just because of the trying to get over the psychological stress of everything I had to do. So that's another reason why I'm slowing it down for 2 weeks, for health reasons, and also because there's all this stuff back here that I can't, you know, I just got to take care of all these little details and things I got to build. And I don't think I'll make videos about all the stupid things like doing the ventilation system, but I might do another live broadcast, you know, later on, and just recap all the little things, kind of like what I'm doing here. Oh, look at this. The stream is in the green. Well, look at that. Okay, we're 53 minutes in, and we're back in the green. So we're broadcasting full, oh, we're broadcasting full 720. Okay. All right, so I'm going to look at the chat. All right, see, order pizza. Yeah. Philly pizza's, you know, dicey. Oh, okay, it looks like they're talking about the chips. All right. Did you make any science video about the Hyperloop? No, that's not a Philly thing. Peter, yes. Hello, Peter. Yes, longtime supporter. My Patreon support is not going anywhere. I thank you, Peter. Thank you. Yeah. Moving sucks, yes. That move, I've moved. That was move number 18 for me. 18 moves in my adult life. But this last move, this was the hardest of them all. It was the hardest one for several reasons. One is it was done under duress because I wasn't wanting to move. Two is because of the complexity of the fact that I wasn't moving from one location to another because this was a smaller space, so I had to break it up. It was logistically complex. It was very expensive. And also the costs of rent and stuff that I had to, you know, had to negotiate. They're demolishing a building across the street, so you're going to hear some of that. No, this was the most stressful move. That's another reason why I got to take some time these next couple weeks, because the psychological stress was immense. I'm trying to get my mind back in the creative mood. And I've been late at night, because I don't really, you know, I haven't been sleeping in the middle of the night. I've been thinking, you know, that like my brain, I've been trying to think about projects, and I can't remember where I was on this clock project, or where the drivers were, or what was I going to do about that display project. And there's like this dulling of my brain. And so the psychological stress, like the connections, like the neurological connections for like my processing abilities, it's like my brain's been stunned, you know. And I'm trying to get the creative juices going again, get the synapses talking again, and it's been a process of trying to get in a more positive psychological mood so I can be creative enough to actually do my job, you know, and finish these projects. So one of the things, this is a little update, okay, a little update within this, the Disky display project is not dead. I actually had planned to have a working prototype over the new year, but with the eviction, the whole thing got shelved. And I also ran into a stumbling block, because it turns out that the chemistry that I bought, it's very expensive stuff, but the chemistry that I bought to do the project, I bought it January, February last year. And it turned around this year. I was like, well, I'm going to get started again. But it turned out that those inks have a very limited shelf life. They're only like really guaranteed to have like 6 month shelf life, and so I had had the inks for over a year, and I thought, well, I'm gonna have to, so I'm, I, rather than even using, you know, it's like people are gonna say, well, you can use the old inks. Well, yes, I'm not throwing it away. I'm gonna use those inks for non-critical things and for experimentation, but for the actual display project itself, I wasn't gonna go through, because it's 12 different. You have to. It's 12 different screens, like 12 different layers, just for one prototype display. So I wasn't going to go through the days and possibly weeks that it would take to make even just one display, just to have it completely not function because the inks just were, you know, bad, or have it be like meh. So I had to order new inks, and that cost me well, a lot. So I had to dump three figures into getting new inks, which are on the way. They're actually coming next week. So I'll be doing some experiments with those fresh inks in the weeks to come. I'm really trying to get at least one prototype built for that screen, for that display, before July. So we're still in the green. All right. Time budgeting. Okay, some people are still saying sync issues, but in Philadelphia, we're in the green. So it looks like the sync issues are very regional. YouTube is not being universal in broadcasting these live feeds. So the issue isn't on, I'm broadcasting at 20 frames a second, 720. That's my encoder is synchronized with YouTube on this end. But people are still saying that they can't watch in 720. Why is that? Why is YouTube throttling live streaming on the other end? It doesn't make any sense. Meeting the feeds. Huh, alright. People are surprised to see the thing. How many people got up here? We got 288, so, that's, 288 people, they're hanging in there. All right, we're hitting the 1 hour mark, so I'm going to wrap this up. It's almost 2 o'clock. Today is the finale of the Philly Science Fair, of Philly Science Fest, and they have at the Franklin Parkway, out in front of the Franklin Institute every year on this day, they have the Science Carnival, which I'm going to head over there as soon as we finish this up. I'm going to head on over there because I never miss the finale where they do the liquid nitrogen finale. I did a video a couple years ago of the finale, but I'm gonna see if I can get up close and get some good footage this year. If I do get some good footage, maybe I can edit that down and post that or do that in another live broadcast later on if we sort out these synchronization issues. Yeah, it's been green for like, all right. So, yeah, throttling. They say they don't throttle, but they do. It's true. All right. Getting weird. Okay. Does anyone have any questions? I know we got some lag, so I'm going to ask this, and it's going to take a while for that to show up here. But bad sync. Yeah. I don't know what it, would take to get better sync with YouTube. If the budget's not there, but if I actually looked into getting like a standalone live stream studio. If I purpose build a computer for it, it's going to cost me like in the order of, $3,000 or so. And they actually have standalone like broadcast studios that'll do the whole thing. Like, and they're like more. So there's no cheap workaround with the bandwidth issue. But even if I go with like a dedicated purpose-built computer, I still got the bottleneck issue. It's just like in Philadelphia that I just doesn't seem to be a way to get a better upload speed than what I got right here. You know, and even the cable guy was saying, well, how can I, you know, it's like download is like, you know, 30 megabytes a second or something, and then upload it's like, oh no, they limit it to like 10 or something like that, or 3 or something. I don't know, but the upload, it's like they citywide, they like limit uploads. How does anyone? I mean, there's no such thing as a T1 line anymore, so I don't know how anyone in this city actually does live streaming. Maybe no one does. I don't know. I still don't know how people manage to do it in other places. I guess if you don't live in a major city, they don't throttle the bandwidth so much. But it's the major bottleneck issue. It's the upload issue that. And see, it's been green for half an hour. So, all right, let's wrap this up. Looking for questions. You have questions? Do you? What percentage CPU usage do you have? It's running like 30 to 40%. I'm running an 8-core ASUS, so it's not the CPU. It's kind of just humming along. It's just the synchronization, because like I said, I have the encoder set up to synchronize with YouTube. So as the upload bandwidth drops, it changes its bit rate. It's fluctuating it, so it'll drop the bit rate. It'll drop the frames per second. You know, trying to keep within the bandwidth so it doesn't conk out. And that strategy has worked because YouTube did not cut me off this time, which was the problem with the old system where I was trying to stay rigid within like frame rates and such, and YouTube was just cutting the feed when the bottleneck got too thin. So the fact that I've got the encoder flexible now with the variable bit rate, it's flexing with the bandwidth, but it's still this problem. Like when I went to live, you know, there were just too many people in this neighborhood were taking up upload bandwidth, and it just bottlenecks too small. And now for, I guess whatever it was some kind of a sporting event or something was over. People hung up the phones, as it were, and we've been in the green. So, but that seems to be the major issue. But anyway, why don't you get more bandwidth to buy an IP address? Well, it's not a matter of that. It's a matter of the connection. You know, it's not the destination, it's the corridor. Yeah, it's all about the corridor. All right, well, for those of you who are tuning in late, this will be archived, so it'll be up, you know, it takes like a couple hours, but it'll be in the videos, so no worries about that. 264 of you watching, all right, cool. And, you know, leave some comments if you want me to keep doing these, even at the low band. This is like, you know, like I said, with the bandwidth issues in Philly, this broadcast, it seems to be the best I can do. I might be able to improve it a little bit with a new encoder or something, but again, that's, I don't know, maybe not. Might not make a difference, so. So anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll make a video in the near future, like I said, I'm going to the science thing, I'm going to do that, and then, but I'll... A couple weeks, next couple weeks, it's going to be a little lax, but I got to catch up on all this fine detail stuff. I got to get a ventilation thing set up so I can, because I got to do soldering, and I got to get my test equipment hooked up and get all the, you know, fine details next couple weeks. Anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. And, a lot of people saying they want more singing. I don't know. I get probably an equal number of people saying, stop the singing, it's creepy, and as many people saying, we want more singing, so, I don't know. It'll have to be, anyway, that's it. I'll see you around. Bye!